Test, 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 test. Hey everybody, welcome to my studio. My name is Michael Markowsky. Merry Christmas for those of you who celebrate Christmas around the world. I'm here live in my studio, and today I'm gonna be making a painting. I invite you to join me along the ride if you like, or you're certainly welcome to just watch, and hopefully I'm entertaining. And it's not just watching paint dry for a couple of hours. So, I already see lots of people in the chat there. I'm so grateful that you guys are spending a little bit of your holidays with me there. So, it's that's super cool. So, maybe you have a little bit of family or friends who are gathered around the computer screen watching you. Maybe they're going to paint along with you. Some of you have been painting with me for a few months now, and some of the work you guys are sending me is amazing, which reminds me, on Saturday, in just a couple of days from now, on Boxing Day, that's how we call it here in Canada, I'm going to do a special bonus episode where I'm just looking at artwork that you guys have made over the past month, from I think episode 21 to 30. And depending on how many I get there, because there's only a few for the last few episodes that I've seen, one of the things that I'm probably going to focus maybe more on is artwork that you guys have made outside of class, that you guys, you know, inspired by some of the things that we've done together, that you guys have sent me. Because I've got about 30 or so images, really cool paintings that you guys have sent me that aren't, you know, directly tied to anything that we've been doing, but you guys, some of you have never painted before, but started painting and are now so excited about painting, you're doing all sorts of other things. So I want to show some of that. And because I think that's really inspiring for other people who are sitting and thinking like, oh, one day I'm going to do this and one day I'm going to learn how to paint. And then, but I don't know if I want to paint any of these paintings. But I think if I would be speaking to some of those people, is you'll see that what we're doing is we're learning some of the basics, and once we learn some of those basics, then it really helps us to paint what we really do want to paint and things that are more personal for us, right? So let's get right to it. You'll see in the video description below that there's a link to a link to a Dropbox. Let me see. So if you click on that link, you'll get something similar to this will pop up. And inside here are like, for instance, if we click on today's episode, you will see here's a small version of the painting that we're going to be making. And then there's also a outline. So I traced over top of it with my iPad, and I uploaded the JPEG and a PDF version of them, which you can print out. I would encourage you to do that. I'm going to do two versions of today's painting, one that I'm going to draw by eye and one where I'm going to use the tracing. And because I want to do a couple of fun things, and I want to be able to have the option of having a couple different paintings. But we'll get to some of the fun things that we're going to do onto this painting a little bit later on in the episode. But anyway, I would encourage you to consider doing this transfer process at least once during the course of the course. I think if you do, you might find it a lot easier to get an image on the canvas just to get started. Anyway, so there's that. There's also, here is the private Facebook group for people that have been taking the class. And so this is just for those of you that have been painting along with me, and you can upload your paintings to here. And, you know, this is happening in real time, and, you know, there's 26 people in here. So I'm keeping it, I'm not trying to get everybody in the world in here. So you don't want to invite your brother or sister or grandmother who have never heard of me or aren't interested in painting classes. This is just a private group for those of you here. And what's exciting is hopefully as the time passes, because I'm always getting emails from people who've just started the drawing class I did in the summer, or just starting the painting class. In fact, there's somebody very generously sent in quite a lot of money who's only on episode number 3 of this painting course. And so they can also participate by uploading their images to the Facebook group. And so anyway, well, you can see all that there. So let's get into today's episode. We are going to focus on an artist named Gustav Klimt, a Austrian artist. But before we get there, I think it's just kind of interesting to kind of look at the most expensive paintings up until today, and in terms of what is sold at auction. So here's a Jackson Pollock painting. And just as a little bit of a heads up, in the beginning of January, our second episode in January, we're going to be doing a painting by Jean-Paul Riopel, which was a Quebec / French, European French artist. Although he was born in Quebec, he did spend a lot of his professional career in France, who had a similar kind of style to Pollock. So if you're interested in how Pollock made his paintings, or Riopel made his paintings, we're going to do an episode like that, and this could be a little bit fun, kind of a nice way to spend the beginning of January doing a little bit of drip painting. A Willem de Kooning painting. Look at these prices, $150 million, right? And then this one here, Portrait of Adele Bloch-Bauer, and by our artist today, Gustav Klimt. So $144 million for this painting here. I've seen this painting in person when it sort of first came up for sale. There's a long, complicated history with this painting, which I think we'll talk about as we go here. But it came up for sale in 2006, and then I think it may have sold again recently for a slightly higher price. I can't quite remember, but I think he may also have a few other paintings on this list. Does he? Of course, we got Picasso. What, next three on the list here? Warhol. Okay, so here's the other Gustav Klimt painting. This one, I think this one sold more recently for a higher price. So I think this one is the one that sold for $150 million plus buyer's premium. All right, so this is the same woman painted a second time. This one here, this Rubens painting, by the way, is at the AGO in Toronto. This was a big deal when this sold. And then Francis Bacon. So let's take a look at Gustav Klimt and why his art is so valuable. Why are people so in love with this artist? So you can see here's him in his smock. He was really into fashion. We'll talk a little bit about that. His partner, I think it was his wife, I believe they were married, was kind of a fashion designer and did costumes for different plays, and they collaborated a number of times to make some clothes, and so you will see he's obviously clearly interested in pattern. So he died fairly young, and I'm trying to remember how he died. I think it might have been the Spanish flu, I think, to be quite honest, or what was called the Spanish flu at the time. Kind of interesting that we're doing this at this particular time in history. So let me just, what do I want to say about him before we kind of get started? His father was a gold engraver, that's right. So, which becomes very important later on. His father, obviously, working with gold all the time. I'm not sure exactly, but it does seem, you could imagine Gustav Klimt uses a lot of gold leaf, gold foil in his art later on, particularly in the period of the art that we're going to make today. And I think this might be a little bit of a kind of nod to his father in his art. One of the things that he was a part of, a founding member of this group called the Vienna Succession. And, oops, let me see, what does it say on here? So it was like a lot, so we talked about the Impressionists a few times, because we've done a few Impressionist paintings. And the Impressionists, like the Vienna Secessionists, were artists who weren't embraced by the establishment. And 150 years ago, if you wanted to make a painting and exhibit it, you had to get permission from a bunch of big old white guys who with big beards who sat in a room smoking cigars, and they would look at the paintings, and if they lined up with classical ideas of what painting was, then you'd be accepted and your art could be on display. If, however, you were doing something a little bit different or challenging any of those ideas, forget it. You're just, where are you going to show your art, right? There was a very powerful kind of monopoly that oversaw. So, like the Impressionists here in Vienna, Klimt and some of his friends formed this movement and started exhibiting their artwork outside of the academy. I should also just mention today that there might be some images that may not be safe for work here. I mean, fairly innocuous, but just you might see a little bit of upper chest areas on a woman. So, because he was very interested in painting the nude, right? Which isn't so maybe it would have been kind of, he did get in some trouble for that, for sure. We'll talk about that. But let's jump into just looking briefly at some of his other paintings here. I mean, the first thing you see when we pop this up is look at how yellow or gold, bright golds, these paintings are. This is the painting we're going to paint today, which is actually an excerpt of a larger one. We'll see that here shortly. But, you know, this beautiful color, like very strong contrasts of color. That's what also makes it pop. So we'll talk about that here as we go. And obviously he's very interested in the figure drawing and painting people, but he did make some paintings of landscapes as well. Not as many, but those would be the two things, kind of the two main themes of his art, are the figure and the landscape, 90% of which were the figure. But he didn't paint dogs or cars or bustling streets of people or trains, or I don't know if he painted still lifes. I haven't really thought about it, but anyway, so this is what we're going to be looking at, is a very small excerpt of this painting, The Three Ages of Women, and or of Woman. And let's just jump right to the painting itself here. And I've kind of covered up a few parts of the painting that could get this video taken down, or some people who are a little bit more sensitive or have children around. So anyway, this painting here is intended to describe or show three different points of life in the life of a woman, right? So we have a little baby girl held by a mother, and then here's an older woman in the background, right? Not the most flattering image of this person, but I didn't get a chance to look into what these big black shapes were. I don't know if that's part of the original painting or if this was intended to be installed somewhere. A lot of artists, you know, made paintings or murals that were intended to go in very specific places, so it could be that this was intended to fit around a shape inside of a small, you know, part of it, of some building. Anyway, so here's the painting that we're going to, here's the excerpt of this painting. And most of the people, when they see this painting, they think this is the entire painting, which of course, again, it's just this little cropped part of the painting. So here's the painting. Here is the image you can download from the Dropbox folder, and I've printed one off right here. All right, so I just printed it off on regular paper, and we can use this to transfer it onto a canvas. So let's get right to the painting. Look at all these comments there. Merry Christmas, everybody. Thank you. Lots of well wishes. So, okay. Let's grab our box of tricks here. And I'll just, as I go through here, I'll just show you a couple of little things that are a little bit new. One of which, I don't know why I'm showing two of them, but is here, if you're thinking like how, I've got all these paintings now, I've got like 30 of them, how am I going to display these things? Well, one possibility is you could use these small picture hanging tabs that 3M makes. And I'm sure there's probably another brand. But what's great about these is you can put them on the back of a painting and onto the wall, and they're intended to not damage the wall or the artwork. So they have these kind of little, if you've ever used these things, they're kind of miraculous. They kind of stick, like you could hang some pretty heavy stuff off of them, but then you just pull this tab and it just falls right off the wall. Anyway, so you could put these on the back of, obviously you could frame your paintings if you wanted, but that's a whole other thing entirely. So I've got a couple of canvases which I've pre-gessoed, and I ran out of the old gesso that I've been using for the first 30 episodes, and that was like a 10-year-old jar of gesso. And it was a little bit thin, half of it had kind of congealed in the bottom. So here's a brand new jar, and you can see this is $31.50. I gessoed about 25 of these things yesterday with this, and I used maybe this much of it, right? So if you're thinking of getting one of these things, you could probably get away with the small jar, which, you know, is not even, it's half the size, like a, you know, so it's much, much smaller. And I think it was $16 or something. I'm not even sure which make or company this is. I think when I went to the art supply store, they're like, do you want the professional grade or the student grade? And I just said I wanted the student grade version. The golden makes a much more expensive version that I think was like $70 for about this size, and I'm like, no way, it's not worth it. To be honest, even if I was making them myself, I probably wouldn't use that really expensive gesso. I just don't think it's worth it, right? It's gonna get covered up. Probably it's not, I mean, I'm trying to think, the difference between a cheap gesso and an expensive gesso, the idea would be that it's using higher grade materials, and I'm sure somebody will correct me at some point, but I can't really think of what would make it's basically just plaster dust and medium, like acrylic medium. So anyway, so I got my canvases, I've pre-gessoed them. Usually when I do this, I should have taken a photo, but I had like the whole floor here covered with newspaper, and I just gesso one, just put it on the floor, gesso another one, put it on the floor, left it to dry overnight, and now they're ready to paint on. So I'm going to sand these really quickly. And again, I don't know why I mentioned this, because by this point, you probably know what I'm talking about, but I do think there are lots of people, when I look at the analytics for these videos, I'd say half of the people that watch these episodes are watching it for the first time. They haven't seen any of the episodes before. So that's why I know it could be a little annoying hearing me repeat some of this stuff again, but so just give a quick little sand on here. So, I'm just going to wipe this off. I think, are these the same brand? Right, and if you're interested in buying these canvas boards, the link to this particular brand, this Fixsmith, is in the description. Previous to up until about three or four episodes ago, I was just using the free, or not the free ones, but the cheap ones from the dollar store. And I do think these, I was a little skeptical of these ones, but they are better. They do feel more solid, more rigid. The cheap ones from the dollar store are just cardboard inside. And you get the feeling that if they got, and they do, when they get wet, they warp. And actually, now that I had these on the floor, and part of the floor is a little uneven, and I was expecting them to warp overnight, but they look pretty darn straight. So that's, you know, you get what you pay for, right? In this case, it's just an extra dollar from, so it's $2 instead of $1 or $1.25. Okay. So let's, I'm going to draw the original image onto the canvas, and then I'm going to do the photo transfer. So let's find the pencil. I should just hide my 5B pencil. It's too dark. Okay. So let's get right into this here. So I'm going to transfer this image. The first thing, as you know, I like to just divide the canvas into quarters. And here is approximately the middle. Right, again, you could zoom in or out on this image however you want. But I'm not concerned with all of the detail and getting all the hair in the exact right places. But let's say this here, if this is kind of her chin, the mother's chin, we can draw kind of like a potato shape here. Right? And it doesn't matter if you've got the right kind of form or anything at this point, right? It's, you know, just we're just gonna plot out where things go. And then we've got this baby's head somewhere down here. And here's the shoulder, the baby's shoulder. Okay. And then her neck would be kind of here. And then her shoulder coming down like this. Arm. Okay. And then we've got this hair, again, very loosely drawn in here. I'm not even going to bother drawing all that stuff up there, except maybe to define where some of these kind of larger shapes might be. Okay. I got that. So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm just going to draw a line on her face and kind of it's maybe just we have this straight line going right across the horizontal line, so I'm actually just going to kind of tilt it up just a bit. Okay. And let's say if we imagine I'm going to put a line here for some lips. This is going to be where the nose will be. Here's going to be where some eyes are going to go. And the arch on the eyes. Okay. So let's start drawing this in really quickly. I'm going to draw this kind of arch. And this. Actually, I'm going to move back here like that. And then we've got these lips. We'll just kind of start it pretty simple. Right. Okay. Okay, so now we can kind of just change her chin a little bit. And then all of this, we're gonna just paint in here as we go. So I don't wanna worry about getting that too close. Okay. Now we want the baby's face down here. And I was gonna go in here and fiddle with the nose and all that stuff, but we'll do that. All this is gonna get painted over with, right? So I don't really even bother. Let's see, down here with the baby's face. We've got this kind of circle. Right, I'm kind of doing a very, very brief portrait tutorial here. Let's say if we imagine that there was a line, like there was a tennis ball. Right, so if you imagine, here's a ball, right? And if we kind of imagine that it's on its side there, does that make sense? So we've got that. And then I'm gonna do the same thing here. You don't have to worry about getting it all perfect, but just kind of helpful. So here we have this eye curving around, right? And then kind of coming down. A little nostril. Okay. And then if we imagine this would be on another line as well. Here's that other eyebrow. There was another one down here. Okay. And some lips. Okay. So I've accidentally rotated the head a little bit more, but I'm not going to bother fixing it here. We've got a little ear that's probably just going to get hidden by hair. So we got all this hair is going to jumble up in here. So here's the shoulder. Okay. Next we've got a hand. This, you know, this might be helpful even if you're not going to do this, but you could draw this on a sketchbook so that you can kind of practice a little bit about how to draw if you wanted. So this is going to be the hand, and let's just think, okay, we've got these fingers, or how many have I got? Here's 1, 2, 3, 4, and this should be a thumb under here, but it's kind of hidden, right? So we got 1 finger, 2 fingers, 3 fingers, 4 fingers. Another one there. Oh yeah, here's baby's armpit. Yeah, so all of this is gonna be hair that's gonna be, we're gonna paint in. Okay, so that's one way of doing it, just kind of drawing it out this way. And let's do the image transfer on another canvas. Right, so if you're doing the image transfer, right, we can take this, and I've shown this many, many times before. So if you want to watch kind of a pretty in-depth way of how to do it, you could watch the Warhol episode, which I think is episode 21, perhaps. This is a sheet that I used I've used twice before. I used it for the previous episode, the Thomas Kincaid, and also for the Renoir. Let's see, just for curiosity's sake, if we can get another drawing out of this. Ace says, "Hi Michael, can you please put a open button to open up the live video. I have trouble to get in. Thanks, Paula from Canada." I'm not sure I understand what that means. If you have any trouble watching the video, you could just refresh the video, just like refresh your browser, stop it and start it again. And then you could just, you know, at the very bottom there where on the timeline there's a little red dot, you can kind of just drag it all the way to the right, and that should go to the live view of the episode. Okay. Because I don't really know how I could add a button to help you there. Okay, so I'm getting a red pencil. I just like a red pencil because it sticks out as much as possible. So, I'm also just, this is a little bit more of a complicated one. And you have seen me be sloppy before where I'm just holding it down with my hand. Really what I should be doing is taping the image down so that it's not sliding all over the place. All right, I'm gonna fold these back so it peels off nice and easy. See, I always tend to put these things upside down. Okay, so let's see if this old piece of graphite paper has a little bit of life left in it yet. So I've got that graphite or carbon paper, same thing. I mean, slightly different substance, so I guess technically not the same thing, but they do the exact same thing. Let's see. So this method is helpful to a point, right? It's just helping you get your drawing onto the canvas and helping you kind of space things out. Once it's there, then you can, you know, fill in any details that you think would be helpful. Okay. Put a few of these just locks of hair, just so. Here's where the ear goes. And I think that's all I really want to do, right? Have I got, oh, here's an eyebrow. So let's check this out and see how well we did. Moment of reveal. Great. Right, so is there anything else I would need to do in here? Just like the previous one, I'm just gonna maybe draw in this top ridge here. I think that's good enough. So I'm, you know, I've got three paintings out of that one sheet of carbon paper. I remember when years ago I used to buy it individually. It would come in these big, great big sheets. Then you have to buy them and then cut them down or tear them to smaller pieces. Okay, so I've got this. Let's just move this graphite paper out of the way. That's great. Thank you so much, everybody, for helping Paula get into the class there. And again, I'm super lucky to have such a great community of people who are helping each other out and who are all invested in learning and getting better and better. Man, that's why I'm doing a class on Christmas Eve, is because you know, I really enjoy spending time with you guys. Okay, so let's start painting these paintings. And let's take a quick little detour here just to examine the original and kind of just thinking about some colors. Now, obviously, I want to remind people that you can change the colors at any time. You can add things, you can delete things. If there's parts of the painting that you're really into, you can add more of it. If there's parts of it that you don't like, you can remove it. You could put a mustache onto this character, this woman here, or turn it, put a sunglasses on there, baseball hat, or a sweater, or a Christmas sweater. I mean, feel free to really play with your paintings. When we talk about Jean-Paul Riopel in a few weeks, one thing that's amazing about him is he just sort of like exudes creativity, right? You just get the sense that he never runs up against a wall, or if he does, he's just like, okay, great, I'm at a wall. What can we do with the wall? Let's do something. This is now a new opportunity, kind of like Bob Ross and the happy accident, right? So, what colors are we going to put on this painting? So, just looking at this and trying to kind of deduce what is where, how he would have painted this. So the question in my mind is, when I see some of this blue, I wonder, is that for the first layer, or are these final lines that he's putting down at the very, very end? And I don't quite know, but you know what I would suggest we do is that we should match, get this hair. In fact, the more I look at it, I feel like this yellow that's there was probably his underpainting. And that would be probably the fastest and the smartest way for us to approach this painting, would be to lay down this kind of yellow to get started. Okay, so let's get some paint out and we'll start the mixing process. Okay, so I'm glue all my tabs on here. You know, it was interesting while I was coming up doing a little bit of research for this show, you know, I was looking up like Christmas paintings, like what's a Christmas painting? And to my surprise, like there's a lot of kind of overtly religious Christian stuff, which is not surprising. It is a Christian holiday. There is lots of paintings of, you know, Jesus and Mary, and but a lot of them are also like, first of all, a lot of them were way too complicated for us to paint. And I'm sure some of you are like, this isn't too complicated, but trust me, we're going to walk through this step by step as we've done for the past few months. We're going to get through it all together, no matter your level of painting ability. But I also wanted to make this, I know that not everybody's going to be, in fact, the vast majority of people who are following along to this lesson are not painting it live. And in just a few days from now, Christmas is going to be over, right? So I also didn't want to make a painting that was like only useful for people, like 10 people in the live stream. I was thinking like, what other kind of painting would kind of give us a feeling of evoke some of the feelings that come along with Christmas, and probably the big thing is family. And and also be something that we could paint in a couple of hours. And this seemed to be a pretty good, I wouldn't even say compromise. I feel like we're gonna be able to do everything that we want to do in this painting here. And that's, you know, I have a wife and daughter. And so for me, it's a little bit selfish, right? I'm like, but actually, if you Google Christmas paintings, you know, this is one of the ones that pops up all the time. So anyway, so I've got my palette. I've got all the paint on there. And I think we're gonna use a little bit of black. You don't have to use black if you don't have it, but it could be helpful because it looks like there is a number of grays in this painting, on the skin particularly. So, but we'll get to that as we go. So you probably don't need as much black as I put down on there. Okay, so the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna mix this yellow. And this is just, I think for the entire painting, what I'm gonna do is just paint a warm wash. Kind of like when we did the Thomas Kincaid, we want something that kind of has a glow to it, right? It's a warm glow, and there's not really any background to this painting. So we don't really have to worry about putting warm and cool colors in here, because it's not like there's a mountain hiding in the background, and you know, there's this, part of Gustav Klimt's paintings is a kind of a flatness that's going on, right? You have these people that are surrounded, immersed by pattern, right? They're sort of being swallowed up by this abstract, these textures. So, the color that I'm gonna use here, I'm gonna take this warm yellow. And you could put this directly on there. Although I'm just gonna give it a little bit of red to warm it up a little bit more. I mean, it's a little bit too red, a little orangey. I need a little bit, I've got two paintings to cover here, so. Need that. I'm also gonna give it a little scoop of the white, not too much. Just because it's just gonna, by adding a little bit of the white in there, it's going to dull the kind of orangey yellow down a little bit. So I'm just gonna add a little bit more of that. And where did my little eyedropper go? Okay, there it is. So just, I'm gonna put a little bit of water in here, and I don't recommend having a little water dropper. I don't think it's as useful. And I'm just using this just so people can kind of get an idea of how much I put in there. It's probably like, what, 5 or 6, 10 drops around there of water. It's not a ton. This, because we are putting down a wash, it's just going to make it go on a little bit easier, really get into all the little nooks and crannies. Okay, looking good. Okay, so let's do one at a time. Okay, where's all these shadows coming from? Okay, so I'm gonna start painting this on here. And you can be, you know, pretty quick and rough about how you paint this on. Ideally, you know, what I would have done is maybe not paint so, or draw so dark onto that surface when I first kind of drew this out. But we'll paint over everything anyway, so. Okay. Right now, we're just kind of thinking about. That's pretty darn good. It might look a little bit more yellow or red depending on how much, how you mixed it, but you know, as long as you've got a bit. You could just use the warm yellow right out of the tube. I put a little bit of warm red and white in it just to kind of dilute the intensity of that warm color a little bit. We'll do the same thing again. Might need to mix a little bit more as I go here. Okay, so I got two of these on the go. Clean my brush up a bit. So probably the kind of order of this painting is I'm gonna work on the skin, these flesh tones, paint those in. I'll do, what's kind of nice is that they're very similar, mother and daughter here. And then I'll start painting in the hair. And then among the last things is doing these flowers on there. Now, one of the things that you may want to consider doing is going a little bit nuts and adding some other materials onto your canvas. You don't have to, but if you want to go a little bit crazy, I just realized I'm not wearing my painting pants and I'm just so used to wiping my hands all over the place. So we'll see if these... They're only kind of my sweatpants, but I probably have a new pair of painting pants. I was just thinking the other day, I need a new pair of painting pants. Ask and you shall receive, right? So here's a kind of a box of random things that I usually I bring to my classes. Here's some glitter. I think I've got a bunch of glitter somewhere. Here's some little flowers and gold leaf things. Googly eyes if I wanted. Some googly eyes. Let me see. Yarn if you wanted. You could try gluing some yarn down in place of the hair. Right. Won't need these. Look at all these little stickers. Oh, here's a bunch of dolphins. I don't know if you can see any of that. I don't think I'm gonna put dolphins on there, but why not, right? Okay. So I'm just kind of pointing some of this out, both because I'm waiting for some paint to dry. But if you want, one of the great things with acrylic paint is that it can act as an adhesive, right? There's essentially what's in acrylic paint is a lot of, it's very similar. It's not exactly the same thing, but it's very similar to white glue with pigment in it, right? So you could glue things onto the canvas simply by just smooshing it into the wet paint. Now, I also have a hot glue gun that could also work quite well, obviously, for sticking things onto your canvas. So, if you have one, you could use that for today's painting as well. I'll just move some of this stuff off here temporarily. So that's why I'm making two paintings today, is we'll have one version that is done in the traditional way, kind of like Klimt would have done, and then another one where I'm going to get a little bit crazy and funky and wild. So, and that's also just as a reminder that, you know, if you're making a painting and you're not fully happy with the way it turns out, rather than just throwing it out, use it as an opportunity to experiment on, like literally graffiti over it with other materials. You know, there's certainly lots of people will paint another painting over top. You know, they'll just cover it with white paint. But, you know, these canvases cost $1 to $2. Rather than painting an entirely different painting over it, I would really suggest manipulating the painting you have and just doing something kind of fun to it. Like, especially if you don't like it, then there's nothing to lose, right? You could, again, as I said, draw mustaches on things. There's a history of that too we can talk about. Have a good Christmas dinner, Heidi. Thanks for joining us. Okay, so that's what's handy about having the hairdryer out here, is I can speed up this process a little bit. So let's go right in here to painting the skin tones. So let's look at this. So what colors do we want to paint for this? I will say that the way that he's painted these figures, and this is kind of typical for Klimt, is they're a little bit pasty, these people, right? And like his friend Egon Schiele, who is a little bit younger than Klimt, but they were good friends, the two of them were, you know, have this particular kind of look of their figures of being a little bit emaciated, you know, like very over, like a little bit too thin, kind of pale. I don't know what that look is why, but so you can go very, very pale like them, or you could choose to kind of warm these characters up a little bit. It's up to you. There's no sort of right way to do any of this. So let's start with this one. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is we're gonna start mixing some skin tones. And I'm gonna kind of I'm not going to go quite as pale as he's got here. So just as a... okay, so to make a skin tone, what I can do, and let's get a little bit more warm yellow on here. And we're going to need some more white. So to make a skin tone, regardless of whatever race, is you want some warm yellow. You want some warm red. Right, you're going to make it like an orange to start. And then you're going to add a little bit of warm blue. Not too much. And what this does is it creates a brown. Right? And so, depending on how dark your skin is, right, this could be, you know, this could work really well. I'm going to add some white into it. All right, so this here, you know, is approaching kind of a Caucasian skin tone, and we'll just kind of warm it up a little bit more. And it's a little hard to compare to your own skin. Like sometimes you'll see artists will actually paint onto their hand like this, right? So if I wanted to get closer, I could keep on mixing some red in here and some white. It's a little bit bright, but I think I'm going to use this anyway. Well, let's just see. His again, have a lot more white, like, and a little bit more blue in them. All right, so I don't know. I'm not too concerned about mixing a perfect skin tone here right now. Let's just see. That is, you know, now that I see it against this, I think I do want to add a lot more white. But that's going to be pretty gray, right? So, add a little bit more red back into this. Ah! It's got a bunch of black on there. Okay, let's move over here. So as I paint this, I'd want to be kind of thin with how I apply this, because I want the previous layer of that warmth to kind of be bleeding through this heavy paint. There's all that white. Oh, okay. See how I'm kind of scrubbing around here, trying to just kind of massage this paint in. Aww. Okay, maybe it needs a little bit more down here. That's pretty good. Kind of for a nice, for our base layer, that's pretty good. You see, there's still pencil lines coming through here. I'm gonna do this on the other one as well really quickly. And then I got a little special surprise for you guys. And you see, notice how I'm like not afraid to go into the hair there at all. Like I'm not, don't worry about making it absolutely perfect. Oh, I just realized this is, well, you know, I can always paint over that later, so. And often, you know, our, in this case, that hair is literally going over top of the skin. So sometimes you want the skin to kind of be showing through some of the hair too, so. So I'm gonna put that aside, and I'm gonna take just a couple of seconds here as a little break and do a little bit of a detour, and invite my wife and daughter back here. If you saw the episode we filmed a couple days ago when we did a Bridget Riley painting. I don't know if everybody saw the, I did a part two to it where we worked more on that painting. And let's see. So my daughter, our daughter, helped get this painting this to this point here. So you may remember there was some blue and red that she painted in here. Well, I felt like that was great, but I want a little bit more. I want her to do even more on this painting. And so I'm gonna get her in here. We're gonna add a little bit more paint onto this surface here. So let's just clear all the things that can be grabbed out of the way. Okay. Let me see, is it okay to get stuff on these clothes?
Yeah, that's fine. These shirts will dirt all stained anyway.
Here's our daughter, Edie.
Hi! Can you wave? Can you wave, say hi?
Okay, let's hop down in here.
Edie, wave, say hi!
Yeah. Remember this? Remember we were doing some finger painting a little while ago? We're gonna do a little more finger painting. And we're gonna need those wipes probably to.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so which colors should we use this time? Oh, you're right in there. Okay, let's get some yellow and blue.
Whoa.
And why don't we put this right in here? Good job. We'll get it started and then I'll let you go even more nuts. Want more? Okay, let's get some more of this. We'll get you some into there. Okay, what other color can we get in here? Let's get some.
Oh, she's eating it.
Oh, she is?
Yeah.
Oops. Okay, we'll get a little red in here.
Well, I thought maybe we'd go for a walk, but maybe we're not gonna make it.
Edie, I love you. You're so funny. What other colors do we want?
These are clean. I don't know.
Yeah, those the wipes in that jar right there next to the power plug. Look at the power plug.
Yeah, but it was just beside it.
Okay, yeah, those are fine. Okay.
Oh, someone from Brazil. Edie, are you troublesome? Watch your
hand. Yeah. Nice. Good
job. That's great. Break for everybody. Have a sip of tea or coffee or wine or whatever you're drinking.
Edie, you crack me up, girl. Okay.
You messy monkey! Dirty baby.
Okay. So we're going to move this out of the way. We'll let that dry.
Work of art.
Beautiful. Okay. So let's clean your fingers off first.
Oh, Edie. If there's a way to put it in her mouth, that's what she's going to do.
You don't want her... It's... Why are you coming on this camera? You don't want to be on camera?
I like, where's your wife? I'm here. I just look gross. I'm always hiding.
No, you don't.
She's the Merry Christmas.
Most beautiful person I know.
I like that Donna wrote, Daddy needs a kiss with all that paint.
Yeah. Oh, no, I just washed your hands, kiddo. Okay. Do you mind finishing some of this up? How did you get this more paint on you? Where is it coming from?
Maybe from your hand. But I can.
It's probably
do
on
it.
The table.
Or yeah.
I just don't want to get too much paint on you either.
Oh, I don't
know. Okay.
Bye, everybody. Have a happy holiday. Merry Christmas.
Thank you. Love you, sweetheart. We'll see you in a little bit. Okay. Thank you, everybody, for indulging me there. That's something. Yep.
Thank you.
Don't forget the llama.
Bye. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year.
Okay. So. Let's. Where were we? We're working on a Gustav Klimt painting, right? So. What are we doing here? We are. So we've got our base layer here of paint. Let's get the. Okay, so right, we went kind of thin. I didn't put it too thick because I still want as much of the warmth to be kind of coming through as often as possible. And especially when you're painting figures, Well, it depends. Obviously, there's infinite ways of doing this, but kind of the more classical way of painting a portrait is by using many layers of thin paint, right? That's how the Mona Lisa would have been painted. And it makes, it's a little bit more time consuming, but it's less risky. You know, if you're afraid of like going too dark or too light, if you're putting very thin, almost like washes of paint, then you're always able to play it pretty safe, right? Because the painting is only changing very slightly at each layer. Now, obviously, we're going to try to get this painting done in the next hour here, so we're not going to put as many layers on there, but this is kind of how one would paint, right? So we've got a base layer on there, and okay, so the other thing, as we start going, if you saw the episode we did just a couple days ago on Thomas Kincaid, and one of the things I was saying that he does a lot is blending, right? He does a lot of the very smooth kind of blending, and so you can also do a little bit of that in this painting too, with an extra brush. And as we get some paint on there, it's just taking it and kind of softening up any brush strokes. So what I think is interesting about Klimt, and let's just bring this up, is he's got both a combination of that smooth blending that we see in classical painting that Thomas Kincaid embraced, and simultaneous to that and adjacent to it, we have a much more kind of radical modernist approach, very flat use of shapes, patterns, and color. So he's got these kind of two approaches to painting in the same painting, you know, swirling and mixed up all together, which I think is kind of the specific kind of key to his work. Okay. And May says, are you going to remove the tape? Yes, I will take the tape off a little bit later on here once it's all dry. So you can stay tuned for that, or tune in at the end if you like. Okay, so let's see. What do we want to do next? We're going to work on the face a little bit more. So where's my brush? Here it is. Okay. So we've got this layer on. I'm gonna go a little bit lighter. And so I'm just gonna take some white, my skin tone. So take this and you can kind of put some of like up on her forehead here. Bridge of her nose. And I can take this extra brush and just kind of soften, blend it in. With the point being that we can't see the edge of any brush stroke. Right? You can see there's a little bit there, I kind of overly softened, right? You just take your brush, add a little bit more. Okay, we'll come down under eyes there, right on her nose. Okay, so I'm just looking for the highlights on her face. Like, where are the brightest areas? Right? One way to do this is by squinting your eyes. You know, know, like kind of pretending like you're trying to sleep a little bit. You know, when you're, if you're on an airplane, if anybody remembers being on an airplane, if you're on an airplane and they're coming up and down the aisles to pass out food or something, you're like, oh, was that something? Do I want to pretend to keep on sleeping? Or, right, you're opening your eyes for a brief instant. Okay. Let's look at her neck here. Like, the lighting in this painting is a little bit strange, right? It's, I mean, this painting is like a bizarre, abstract kind of thing. What is that? All of them. So there's the, where the shadows are and all that stuff. It's a little bit hard to kind of tell what the reality of this situation is, and I don't think it really matters. It's kind of like the overall lit very brightly, right? It's a little bit unnatural, in fact, right? The way it's lit. Right, so here was a little spot of water that I'm not sure how it got on there. Probably because I'm being sloppy with the way I'm cleaning my brushes right over top of the canvas. So, that's a little bit, I can, and it's going to be a problem until it fully dries there. If, in this situation, what's great is I can, let's say, this green, I don't know, some kind of foliage or something, leaves, I can just extend that and cover that right where that goes, right, if I want. So I haven't used any water, except for that initial bit of water I put on for the wash. Otherwise, what I'm just doing a lot of is just using a lot of, it's basically a dry brush technique that I'm using here. I'm just gonna set this aside really quickly and do this one. And so I'm out of paint, so I'm just gonna mix this again, right? So I take a little bit of that color, that brown that I have, and then a bunch of white. So it can actually be pretty close to the one that I used to put this down. I'm just adding maybe a little bit more white to it, or even just applying it a little bit thick, more thickly onto the painting. Super subtle kind of effect, and that's what we want. We want it to kind of look like it's, we want it to be believable, and we don't want any brush strokes, I guess is what I'm kind of leading to here. And you could see, you could spend a long time doing this. Like, this painting I'm working on here, you know, I've maybe going a little bit more, doing this a little bit more carefully than I did the previous one. But ultimately, it's just the careful application of this paint, kind of blending things in, that's going to make it really work really well. So how about, I'm just going to continue working on this one for a second. I need a little bit more white. So I'm going to try to get all of the highlights in on this painting right now. I would probably do this in 3 or 4 separate layers, but just because of time, I'm going to move a little bit faster here. So you see I got these two paintbrushes ready to go. You really want to do this as soon as the paint is on the surface of the picture. You really want to, with oil paint, I could do this and go and have a shower and go for lunch with some friends and come back and nothing has changed. With acrylic paint, however, it's drying so fast that I've got 20, 30 seconds to get as much done as possible before this paint really starts to seize up on the canvas. You know, doing this is rough on a brush. Like, this is gonna kill this brush, right? So if you're if you've got a really expensive brush, you don't really need to use a really expensive brush for this kind of technique. Let me see. You see, I'm just scrubbing it in. If you're, like right now, this paint is kind of a little bit dry. What I can do is I can take my brush This is the one I'm doing the scrubbing with. I just dipped it in some water and I'm gonna dry it off a bit, scrub some of the water off, and then I can come back in. See how can it's very, very, very subtle. And I, again, I'm going pretty fast, so you know, it's part of me is like, oh, this is driving me crazy. It's I'm not gonna be able to make it perfect, but you know, we're not expecting perfection in a couple of hours when we're trying to get these paintings done. But you think once you understand the basic technique. Pretty effective. And you could spend as long as you want doing all of this. I think, let me see, how much more do I really want to do before I move on here? Okay, let's just see here. You could, so, I'm gonna put this one aside. Let's come back to this one here. And I'm gonna add a little bit more red to this one. I'm gonna warm it up a little bit. So I'm gonna take some warm red and add it into here. And I'm even going to just dip my brush into the water a little bit, just to wet it down a little bit, because we are kind of doing some washes. And I want it to kind of spread as thinly as possible. Okay. So, again, got my other brush at the handy here. So this is, we're going to start building up this blush. Thank you. let's, I'm gonna do this, the other one really quickly while I got the paint all mixed. All right, so. And so I'm just going to keep on going. I'm going to add a little bit more red in here. Get this cheek here. You see what's happening? Is that there's this paint was still really wet, so if you have a problem like that, just if we can get to it really quickly, we can just kind of wipe some of it off. All right, so that was that red paint was still a little too wet, or the previous layer was still wet, and I ended up having like scrubbing it away as I was painting on it, so. But you know what, I think, rather than just continuing doing this very subtle approach to painting here, I am gonna pick it up and it's a little bit. I just realized I was using the cool red here. I should have been using the warm red. Okay. So that explains why. I was like, that is such a pink. Here's a little bit more of the color I want. Oops, and I just used the wrong brush for. Put some paint on my scrubbing brush. Right, if this happens, we just scrub it away. Set that aside. I think part of it is I'm trying to do these two paintings at the same time, and it's not ideal. So let's just. I'm just gonna try to maybe focus on one at a time now. Okay. So I think just in the interest of time, I'm going to go to the dark here and start doing a little bit of outlining. So I'm going to take my brush. And so this previous color that I had before, I'm just going to add a little, dip my brush into the water here. But if I wanted to mix that again, in fact, I think I'll need to anyway, so let's just do it. My warm yellow. A little bit of warm blue. And my warm red. And I get a brown. And I'm gonna add a little bit of white in here. So this is a pretty dark color comparatively, but just because I'm kind of, I want to move a little bit faster. Should we use a smaller brush for this? I'm going to kind of do a little bit of outlining, really. Take another brush. And I can use this to soften things up if I want. Okay. Another way of doing this that doesn't involve so much using of the blending is if you just get a little bit of paint on your brush itself, it will dry out, and then you can use that brush to do the blending, as I'm doing right here. Very small brush. Once that all that paint has sort of come off the paintbrush, blend it around. I can use my finger in here just to kind of take out any sharpness. So I'm going to kind of just abandon a little bit of the trying to do this exactly like he would have and try to get the real soft kind of edges and just kind of go for trying to get the painting as done as quickly as possible. So it'll have a slightly different effect overall. Doing this kind of soft blending, as you can see, is a bit of a slow and tedious process. So I'm starting out with this darker brown, and again, I would have blended this in very slowly before, very carefully. But so we could have really nice transitions from light to dark. But we're not going to do that today. Putting in this brown, I'm going to go in with some blue at some point. So I'm just going to take this and I'm going to start painting the child's hair here. Okay. And maybe while I'm here, you know what I might start doing is doing her hair. I can just use this same color here. We're just gonna depending on your temperament is kind of the funnest part of the painting or the most tedious part. I love painting hair. And I'm just gonna use this same color. And I'm just kind of inventing, oops, let's see, get that on the screen there. So this, there's the child's hair and then the mother's hair. This is gonna go darker shortly. It's not in this painting. I'm just going to carry her hair down a little bit further. Again, I should be doing this a little bit more carefully, but so you decide where and how you want to apply these here. I'm gonna just touch up a little bit of white that I had put down there in the face layer earlier. This brown, I'm going to add a little bit more blue into it. And I'm also going to take a little bit of the other blue, the cool blue, just to get a slightly different, darker brown. So with these strands of hair, you can kind of layer them on top of one another. Again, these are, I'm kind of being a little bit sloppy, but you don't even have to worry about making them look too clean either, because you're potentially going to cover them up a little bit with the flowers anyway, so you can kind of be a little bit rough. You can go over top of them later on if you're unhappy with them. So on this side of the painting, this is where the third woman that's not in the painting, that's her darker hair kind of coming down here. So I'm just to extend the mother's hair around here. So I'm just kind of, with just like hair, trying to find ways of letting it overlap in different directions. Some kind of run up against one another, conflict with one another. That way, it's not all just one kind of, if I just sort of traced one line and the other one, that could look pretty cool. That would remind me of, what's his name? The graphic designer who did the Bob Dylan poster. Milton, what's his name? It's a graphic designer who did a famous sort of psychedelic poster of Bob Dylan in the 60s. His face is silhouetted and his hair is a little brightly colored. I keep thinking Milton Avery. Is it Milton Avery? Yes, Heidi's saying extender or what is called retarder, which is probably not the, I wonder how much longer they're going to keep that kind of name. I do have some of that material. But personally, I wouldn't use, I don't really use it too much. I find it's, I mean, I guess if I wanted my paints to stay open or wet for longer, I would just use oil paints. It seems to kind of, for me to, what I like about oil paint or acrylic paint is how quickly they can dry, and using that rather than trying to fight it by putting these other additives into the paint. But it does work. So, let's see. Okay, so you could see kind of how things are developing here. I'm gonna, this is a little bit tedious getting this done. Once it's done though, I can then add little highlights or shadows on this and go over top of the lines with slightly darker colors, slightly brighter colors. That it'll also give a little bit more volume to the painting overall. I'm just gonna continue painting on it like this. So I was hoping to get to do a second painting and then glue stuff all over it, but just time wise I don't think it's gonna work out today, so we might just, we'll see how I'm doing with time as I go here. But it's possible that also that second one I can use for trying a different technique entirely and go for a much more like impressionist kind of style. I'm gonna get a little bit more funky here. Let's do some coming up here and another one that curls. I'm just kind of making this stuff up as I go along, so feel free to put your draw the hairs however you like. So again, I love doing this kind of stuff because this feels kind of meditative, right? I'm just sort of going with my whim of wherever the line wants to go. And I can kind of almost like shut my brain off while I do this kind of stuff. In fact, I may even just go right over to the edge here. And rather than putting in these shapes, because I can always put those shapes in afterwards anyway. Remember, I'm planning on putting a bunch of flowers all over here too, so if there's parts of it you're like, oh, I goofed and I don't like the way that looks, so that looks a little bit weird, then we can solve it by just plopping down a flower in its place, right? See how it just starts kind of, it's a slow build, but once we start getting there, it's pretty satisfying how it all kind of starts to accumulate into something. And any kind of little problems just seem to kind of evaporate, you know, it's no longer, you know, because there's parts of the way that I've drawn the hair that I'm not happy with at the moment, but, you know, I can't. My sort of, there's so much swirling and motion going on here that I sort of kind of lose track of the parts that I'm not happy with. I'm sort of running dry on this. This is the same sort of paint that I mixed 20 minutes ago. It's getting pretty chunky at this point here. So I'm just trying to use the last little bit because I'm too lazy to mix a little more of it. The one thing you do want to be careful though is, you know, when I first started painting, what I might do at this stage, you know, if my paint is kind of starting to seize up like this and it's getting pretty dry, the tendency is to want to just keep adding more and more water to it. And you'll be painting and it'll look totally fine, but what's going to happen is as it dries, it's going to get like thinner and more transparent. And you'll be like, oh, this is so much fun to paint with. And then when it's dry, it'll have faded. And you'll be like, what? What happened? And then you'll have to go over top of it again anyway just to kind of darken it and kind of integrate it a little bit more back into the painting. And that's can be kind of frustrating. So again, that's why I'm always encouraging people to put as little paint onto their palette that they need so that they have kind of the freshest paint possible rather than trying to make dry paint wet again. I feel like that's a Donald Trump campaign hat. Make wet paint. Make dry paint wet again. Okay. So you see how everything's fairly simple, and I probably could have gotten to this part a little bit faster if I had just accepted earlier on in this painting to, you know, gotten over my perfectionism. But you know, it's a hard habit to crack, right? So I totally identify with, you know, when I see students in my classes who are really obsessed with perfection. It's like I've been there. I'm there still. You know, it's hard to kind of give up that control, which is one of the reasons why I like this kind of format of trying to get the painting done as quickly as possible. I know there's some of these that have dragged on for a few hours longer than expected. But at the end of the day, I'm like, okay, well, I'm just not going to spend 40 hours working on it. I might spend 4. Okay. So here we are. What else should I do here? Now, I think in the interest of time, I'm just going to start going much darker and finish some of this outlining and then put some flowers on in the hair. Okay. So... all these paintbrushes are all clean. This is as we go here. So I'm going to make a dark blue. Well, it will be a brown, but it's going to be a very bluish brown. So, I'm going to take the same colors here. Actually, I'm going to mix it right down here. Okay. And I'm going to add a little bit of white to it. I don't want it to be too dark. And a little bit of black. Give it a bit of tone, so there's a little bit of grayish quality to it. Right now it's a little on the greenish side, so I'm just gonna add more blue and red. I'd rather it be more on the purple brown than on the green spectrum. Pretty green. There we go. All right, so this is kind of gross, muddy color. And it's certainly not black, right? I don't know if you can see the difference between the black and this. But this is probably going to be as dark as I need to go in this painting. This painting doesn't have a lot of black in it, right? Oh, sorry, let's go to this. All one thing you may see in the child's hair is a little bit of blue, and we'll get there in a second here. Just want to apply. Let's go my smaller brush here. Color I've mixed. And let's start getting into some of these a little bit finer details. Her nose. Delicately put in some of these eyelashes. Again, all this stuff, these fingers and armpit, all this stuff is done with a lot of subtlety. I'm sure this painting probably took him months to do. And here I am trying to bang it out in an hour and a half, 2 hours. Which is one of the absurd things about these classes, but I'm going to try to quickly get some of this hair in here. Dipping my brush into the water. I'm going to make a quick little wash. It's going to lighten it up a little bit. Now this is pretty wet. Just gonna take off some of the. Oops, let's come in here quickly. Brush this and darken. So I'm doing that again, and now I'm just going to modify it a little bit with a little bit more blue. this in. Not everywhere. Just sort of building up a little bit of darkness in a few different places. You know, because hair has... Even if you have light hair, there's some areas that are going to be a little bit darker than others. See, I kind of like the painting right now. I kind of like the way it, I mean, I'm still going to put these flowers in here. I'm waiting for this to dry a little bit up there. Let's put some of the lips on here. Okay. So, I'm going to take this warm red. And I'm going to dilute it with a little bit of white. I'm going to add a little bit of black to it as well to get a little bit closer to a gray. That's a little too gray. So see how I just sort of blend things out a little bit? Okay. And now let's just see. So you see how, like, on the palette, I don't know if you, maybe I'll zoom in here. Oh, come on. So on my palette, look how kind of gross and boring this red is. Here's my red, warm red, right out of the tube. Here's where I've added some gray to it. And it doesn't look particularly appealing. But once I put it actually on the painting, it's like, whoa, that is very red. Right? You sort of look at it and think like, wow, that's got to be a lot more candy colored. And then you start painting with it, and because the rest of the painting is kind of quiet, if anything, it should be a little bit less intense. Okay. So again, my brush is pretty dry. See how I'm just barely changing this. There's so many details in this face that we're just not going to be able to capture. Okay, now I am going to take a little bit more red. All right, so the actual red, and just I'm gonna dry my brush off a bit and put this in here. Not much, very subtle, but it is brightening that same thing. Baby's lips. See, there's some blues and yellows and all those sort of things that I'm not going to be able to capture right now. So I'm just going to move on to adding. I think I'm just going to start moving into the flowers now. So what I'm going to do to get the flowers. Is I'm just going to take my white paint here. And I'm just going to start putting little white circles. So I can put these wherever I want. And you can make them bigger, smaller. So the way I'm making a circle is I kind of just start. You could, one way you could do it, well, is to kind of swirl. So you look for parts of the painting you're not happy with. Boom, there goes a flower. I think one thing you want to think about is trying to kind of keep it a little bit random. So moving around. So rather than doing a whole bunch in this area, you just keep on kind of going. You want them to look random, not too organized. Otherwise, it'll look a little bit odd, I think. So. Oh, you know what? I forgot this down here. I'm just realizing. Okay, so this hair, I'm just going to come back over it with the, well, it's a little bit too. On it. I'm also going to have a few of these flowers kind of going in behind her, some kind of over top and some in behind. So here I'm just kind of cleaning up. Remember some of the places where I let the skin tone go out of the lines, right? So just touching that up again. And it's like it was never even happened, right? Again, you see how I'm moving all over the picture. Don't be afraid to let some of these flowers go off the edge of the painting. So any kind of problems I might have had with the face start to kind of evaporate as the more and more I work around other parts of this painting. You know, if I'm really obsessed with trying to make the face right, it doesn't really, it's really only a small part of the painting. So oh, it's still a little bit wet. Take my chances here, though. Yeah, I picked up a bit of the color. Oh, well. How many more of these do I want to add? Good question. Not that anybody asked me, I'm asking myself. That's pretty good. Okay, I think that's enough. I'm going to actually get the hairdryer out here and speed up this process. Okay. Well, Deborah, enjoy Bill Murray's Scrooge. That's a great movie. That's one of my favorite Christmas movies. And Bill Murray is a great actor. I've had the opportunity to meet when I used to live in Los Angeles. Very cool guy. Funny, funny actor. Okay, so final. Okay, so I want to do these flowers. Maybe while. Yeah, let's go right to the flowers. So, ooh, look how all this paint is pretty dry by now. Okay, so let's quickly. So the way I'm going to do these flowers, I got a small brush. Actually, you know what I want? Here, and let's. You know what? I want one more of these spots. If some of these are too transparent, actually, it might be worth just going over some of them and adding a little bit more white. Because as the paint dries, it's going to go a little bit more and more transparent. So I think later on, I will finish that other one. See if there's a way I can involve my daughter in it. Maybe I'll do that and show a little bit of that on Saturday. I'll do it ahead of time and just have it pre-recorded and queued up. Okay, let's try that. Zoom back in. Where should we? What should we focus on here? Okay, so I'm just gonna. He's kind of got these little petals. I didn't even really realize these were flowers at first. They sort of look like buttons or something. And there's many different ways of painting flowers, obviously. I'm just going to take his inspiration. And just sort of going around these little kind of dabs. When it's all done, you know, afterwards I'll go in and put the little black dots in the center. again, I'm using my warm blue, cool blue for some of these, and I don't want to put them, I'm going to randomize this a little bit so that they're not all in the same place. I'm also going to vary the color here shortly. So I'm going to get a bunch of this blue in. And then I'll have a purple and a red and a green. And they're a little sloppy. My paint is definitely, it's really quite dry on here, and if I was to take my own advice, what I would say is put new paint out on the palette rather than trying to make all this old paint work. And, you know, I'm a little bit, these are kind of sloppy things, and usually I would take my time, and I'd probably be spinning the canvas around. But I always have to remember that no one is going to see this painting the same way that I see this painting, right? Most people are going to be much further away when they look at this painting. Very few people are going to get as close to the painting as I am to it at this exact moment. And I think that's definitely something that even experienced painters trip up on, is that they feel like they spend so much time in the details that they don't really think about what the painting overall looks like until the very end. That's why it's a good idea to take a break and to stand back and to look at your painting at different times and just see how it's progressing. Ooh, the Tim Curry version of Scrooge. That's cool. I like Tim Curry a lot. Great actor. Okay, so I'm gonna go for a little bit of a green. I love the cool blue and the cool yellow. I just think it's such gorgeous colors. Honestly, I haven't even looked really at the original painting here for a little bit, so I'm probably going to look at it at the end and be like, oh, you know what? I painted the flowers wrong, right? But But wrong according to who, right? It's all like what your goal is for making a painting. It's a little bit, I'm being a little, pushing my luck, resting my hand on the middle of here, you know, one little blotch of paint on there, and then that's gonna drive me up the wall. So the best way to go about that would be to, if I am like insisting on putting my hand on something, would be to put a piece of paper down. Now there is wet paint there, so don't even want to do that. Okay, I am going to turn this like, it's just very difficult to do this without turning the canvas around. Okay. I'm going to modify this a little bit. Let's get bit of a yellow version. I see one here. It's got some just flowers that are just really mostly yellow with some. Okay, let's go for a little bit of red, orange. Let's just go finish these off with just pure red. What I was thinking, trying to do two of these in one session, but it's always the ones where I think I can do it really quickly that I bite off more than I can chew. Okay, I think I got all those dots done. Cool. So let's, I can even take this same, it's pretty dark purple, and use it to create these spots. So the next episode we're going to do, well, on Saturday I'm taking a look at the art that you guys have made and giving feedback on that. So please send in the paintings that you guys have been working on. Can't wait to see them. I've seen a few of them up on the Facebook group. They're so cool. It's very, very inspiring. And especially if you've got artwork that you've been making alongside the class, I would love to see those results. See what your other interests are. Maybe you're studying other artists' artwork as well. I like Donna is going to put some daisies in there because she was a flower child. That's cool. Oh, and I see she's also sent in a donation through the super chat function there. I always forget to mention that, but I appreciate you doing that, Donna. Very generous of you. If anyone else is interested in leaving a small or large donation, there's a link to the PayPal in the description, video description below. Or if you'd like to contact me in a different way, there you can send me a message through Facebook or through my website. The links are in the description below. As always, please like and subscribe to the channel. Send videos to your friends, but post them on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, wherever else. I'm on all of them. Okay, what is... I'm pretty much done. When I look at this, there is kind of a little bit of blue in her eye, or that I do maybe want to capture just a tiny bit of before I sign off. So I'm just getting some cool blue. Super happy with that last little mark. Just scrub it right away. Armpit here. So I was just trying to think, maybe it'd be nice to have a little bit more of this kind of blue and this child's hair. A little bit of blue in some of these lines. I might call it there. I could again continue working. There's her collarbone is kind of, so there's this big weird gap here. I feel like I do need to address that. Okay. So I do want to make a little thing here. So what I'm doing is I got some blue on my paint, or blue paint on my brush. And let's just delicately, it's too much. Super delicate little dry brush, some dark, some blue, not super dark, but thanks, Deborah, for checking in right at the end there. Okay, almost done here. Right in the home stretch. I'm just doing a little bit of just some delicate kind of highlighting, or not highlighting, the opposite, putting some shadows into a few places. Okay. Okay, I think that's as much as I'm gonna put in for today. So I've taken a few things out. I didn't put the green in here, leaf or what those are. And you know, I could spend a lot more time in here, really kind of touching this painting up. But I think that's pretty good. Right? Okay, so I'm gonna sign this. Okay, I didn't know there's a Sharpie here. There we go. I have to remember to put the right date on it today. Last time I was stuck in 2012 for some reason. So thank you everybody for painting along with me for another episode. You know, I probably, you know, now that I think about it, I probably might have gone a little bit in a different direction. Thinking about how long this took me, and I probably would have gone a little bit faster, but you never really know until you actually do it, right? So, all in all, I think it turned out pretty well. I actually like how it's a little bit warmer than Gustav Klimt's. It's a little bit too yellow down here, but again, I could work on this for another month to get it exactly the way I want to. But overall, I feel pretty good about it. So if you've enjoyed today's episode, please like and subscribe to the channel. I would say half of people, you know, like the video but don't subscribe to and then they're always trying to figure out how to find the episodes every week. So just takes a second, and that way when you ever you go on YouTube, it pops right up there and you'll know exactly where it is and you won't miss it. So enjoy your Christmas, everybody. I hope Santa's kind to you, and I hope that feeling of generosity comes to you, and that you're likewise kind to your friends and family, and let bygones be bygones as we move towards the end of the year. On Tuesday, we are going to be making a Maud Lewis painting. That one's going to be pretty fun. And there's going to be a lot of opportunity to perhaps involve some of the younger people in your family in the painting process. Again, on Saturday, just a few days from now, I'm going to be doing a special episode taking a look at your artwork. Perhaps, we won't be talking about these paintings, because that'll be another few weeks from now we'll do that, but especially anything that you've been painting on your own, I would love to see those paintings. And thank you to all of you guys leaving all the sweet messages in the chat there. I really appreciate being able to spend this time with you and to be able to welcome you into my studio, share a little bit about my passion for art with you. And until next time, I wish you all a wonderful rest of your evenings. Try not to eat too much. That's one of my habits that I get into around the holidays, is really stuffing my face, and then I have to spend all of January trying to work it off, but maybe that's a good thing. What else are we doing in January? Okay, everybody, we'll see you in a couple of days. Take care until then. Bye-bye. Thank you.